Hello and welcome to Starkville First United Methodist Church. We are excited that you will be worshiping with us and our congregation today. We hope that your faith is renewed and that your spirit is uplifted. We hope that this is a time of worship and peace for you.
Welcome to the morning service of First United Methodist Church of Starkville, the church in the heart of the town with Christ in the heart of the church. Our weekly Sunday services are at 8:30 and 11 a.m., and our evening service is at 6 p.m. Join us now as we come together and exalt Jesus Christ our Lord.
This morning we gather as a community of faith as we worship our Lord together, and how good it is to join with you as we do just that. We welcome everyone to First United Methodist Church, Starkville. If you're visiting with us today, we give you a very warm welcome. We hope that you'll find our worship experience very meaningful, and we encourage you to come back and worship with us often as we enter into the Thanksgiving and Advent and Christmas seasons. There will be many meaningful services here at this church, and we hope that you'll come and join us and be a part of us in that. Let me encourage each one of you, if you would, take the time to register your attendance on the attendance pads that you'll find there in the pew. And notice all the announcements in the bulletin. There are always things going on in the life of our church that involve you, and we hope that you'll be involved in each of those things. If you've not yet returned your commitment card, we encourage you to do that as soon as possible. Your church needs your support as we strive to be in ministry week in and week out. If you didn't get a card, there are extra cards in the windows and also at the back, and we'll certainly make those available to you. Don't forget tonight's worship service. Our mission team to Costa Rica will be reporting on their mission to Costa Rica back earlier, and Mr. Fred Curry, who heads up the rice and beans ministry there, will also be here as well. So join us in worship tonight at 6 p.m. And then tomorrow from 4 p.m. to 8 p.m., our church will sponsor a blood drive in honor of and to benefit Bill Baker. Bill received 14 units of blood in the last 3 months. So if you can, please take the time to give tomorrow. Occasionally we have a need for someone who can sit with sick children of single parents who have to work that particular day. And if you're willing to volunteer to do that, please call the church office and we'll put you on the list so that we'll be ready when the need arises. Remember, our community Thanksgiving service will be held here next Sunday evening at 6 p.m., so we hope that you'll be here for that. And then also, our 25th Thanksgiving dinner for the international community will be served on Thanksgiving Day here at our church, the Christian Life Center. And there's so many ways that you can be a part of that. And we encourage you to read the bulletin and then call the church office so that you can help. If you've always had that desire to stand out and ring a bell for Salvation Army, you have an opportunity upcoming. Our church has agreed to take the whole day of December the 10th in front of Kroger, and we'll be ringing the bell. If you would like to do that, we ask you to call and sign up for that. It's a good cause, and we want many people to be involved in that. Let me encourage you, as we get closer to the end of the year, please remember your commitment to the church. Your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service are what makes the ministry of this church what God intends for it to be. So we hope that you'll do just that. Let's remember in our thoughts and prayers today, Lori Burney and her two sons, Josh and Matthew, in the recent loss of Lori's father, Mr. J.F. Burney. Let's remember them as we pray. Now let me invite you to please stand with me as we join together in a call to worship. Give thanks to the Lord.
For the Lord is good.
We who are blessed.
Bless and thank our God who is good.
Let us pray together. O Lord, our God, you are good. Your goodness overflows in each of our lives, and we know that. You show your love for us in so many, many ways. And as we gather to worship this morning, let each of us be reminded of your goodness. But also, Lord, let us be reminded of how we should follow your Son, Jesus, because of your goodness and because of your great love for us. For this we pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Our hymn, Now Thank We All Our God, is numbered 102 in your hymnal. Let us sing together all stanzas numbered 102.
Thank you.
please join me as we unite together in the historic confession of the Christian faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence you shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray together. Holy God, make us a thankful people, because truly we have so much for which to be thankful. We have you, and we have your love, your mercy, your grace. And Lord, we must confess that too many times we've overlooked all that you do for us, and have claimed it all for ourselves. And Lord, we've taken credit for it ourselves. And as we enter into this season of thanksgiving, Lord, may we each find ways to best understand how that everything we are and everything we can ever hope to be comes from you and you alone. Help us, God, to refocus our thoughts and our devotions on you and the work of your Holy Spirit in us and among us and through us. And Lord, today we once again bring our many concerns to you, because people whom we love dearly are struggling. Lord, some are seriously sick and fighting for their lives. Others are fighting with all the issues that life has handed them. People are lonely. People are struggling with finances and family. And Lord, some people are so focused on themselves that they, in what they want and how they want things to be, that they're totally neglecting you and your kingdom. Forgive them and help us, oh God, to be tolerant and loving and yet boldly show them a better way. Forgive us all, oh Lord, for all of our many shortcomings. May we all learn to be like your Son, Jesus, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we invite the children to come down to meet Miss Jane for a message.
Here that I'm carrying. I need some strong people. Tell me how strong you all think you are. Do you think you could lift up, could any of you hold this brick? We won't pass it around because we don't want to drop it on anybody's toe, but you think you could hold this brick? Okay, what about, do you think you could lift this? This is called a dumbbell, and I think this one weighs about 6 pounds. It really feels heavy, but it weighs about 6 pounds. So that would be about as heavy as maybe a bag of flour or something that your mom bought at the store. You think you could lift that up pretty well? All right, now let me ask you this. How many of you think you could lift up a car? A real car, like a big car. Some people are supermen, aren't they?
I am.
Most of us would think that we couldn't lift a car. But I think even those of you who didn't raise your hand that you could lift a car could do it. I think you could lift a car, but not by yourself. Let me show you how I think you could lift a car. This contraption is called an automobile jack. And if you put this under a car and pump this handle like this, you could lift. Can you turn that, Zoe? Try to move it. If that was under a car and set in the right place, you could lift up a 3,000-pound car. Each one of you could do that. Now, you couldn't do it by yourself, though. You'd have to have this jack to make it happen. Sometimes in all of our lives, we've got some pretty heavy burdens that we carry. Now, that's another way of saying that there are things sometimes that we all worry about. Can y'all look this way? There are some things in our life that we worry about, or some things that make our life kind of difficult. And I don't know specifically about you all, but it might be a physical handicap. Maybe there's someone who can't walk well or see well or hear well, and that makes their life hard. There are some families where the parents have lost their jobs right now, and so their family's having financial difficulties with having enough money. Some of us have people that we love very much who are sick, and we worry about those people that are sick. Some of us might even have trouble in school. There are some students who work so hard, but they still have a hard time maybe writing that alphabet the way you want to write it or making a passing grade. Like I said, I don't know what all you might have that you worry about, but almost all of us have things that we worry about. Maybe you've got friends that aren't nice to you or somebody that you're having a hard time getting along with. But what I want to tell you is that no matter what that is, you don't have to worry about that by yourself. You don't have to carry that burden all alone. Listen to what Jesus says in the Bible to us. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Listen again. Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. What Jesus wants us to realize is there's no reason for us to struggle or worry or be afraid, because he's there with us all the time to help us carry that load, to walk with us every day. Now, let me ask you something. Does that mean that just because if we turn it over to Jesus and ask his help, does that mean that like magic our problems are going to go away? No. It doesn't mean that. But what it means is that we can count on him every step of the way, all through our lives, that he'll be there to help us when there's something that we feel like is just too heavy for us to carry. We can turn it over to Jesus and know that we don't have to carry that alone. Because you know what? There's not one burden in this whole world that's too big for Jesus. Not a one. Will you pray with me? God, we thank you, especially as we're approaching this time of Thanksgiving, for your greatest gift to us, Jesus. And we thank you that we don't have to struggle or worry alone, that we can turn to him, and he will help us carry our load. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
All right. We sing for our offertory hymn this morning, How Can We Name a Love? It is numbered 111 in your hymnal. Let us sing together all stanzas, and let us stand, please, to sing.
Thank you.
Let us pray together. Holy God, as thankful people, we present our prayers, our presents, our gifts, and our service to you this morning. Use us totally, completely, that your will might be done here in our community and far beyond through us. For this we pray in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. This morning, our scriptures come from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 25 through 30. Matthew 11, 25 through 30. At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
This morning, we had a baptism in the 8:30 service. And I had someone come up to me and said, "Oh, you must be preaching today." And I said, "Why is that?" Said, "Well, we heard some screaming and crying in the early service, so we figured that was probably you." Won't you pray with me and for me this morning? Merciful God, we ask you to come now. Open our hearts and our minds. May we receive your message. God, I ask that you speak through me this morning. Let it be your voice that is heard and not my own. May they see your face and not mine. And when we are finished here, may we be very careful to give you all the thanks, glory, honor, and praise. For we ask these things in your holy name. Amen. Jim Braddock was a man in the 1930s who found himself in a position like many others. A lot to worry about. All of his money that he had won from prize fighting was in stocks and was now gone. His house, gone. His automobiles, gone. His wife's furs and jewelry, gone. He found himself, like so many others in the Great Depression, struggling. James J. Braddock was a light heavyweight boxer who was forced to retire from the ring after breaking his hand. His wife, May, had prayed for years that he would quit boxing before permanent damage was done. To support his family during the Depression, Braddock worked as a laborer at the docks. But he never gave up on his dream to return to the ring. Several years after his last fight, Braddock's old manager approached him about being a last-minute substitute to fight against a second-ranked world opponent. Braddock jumped at the opportunity. In this case, he was one of those hungry fighters who astonished everyone and beat the odds by winning the fight. Braddock was back in the ring, and he began to win fight after fight against younger, stronger, more skilled opponents. But he was determined now more than ever. In a sports article, Braddock was named the Cinderella Man for his miraculous and spectacular comeback. Braddock got a chance to fight for the light heavyweight championship against Max Baer. It was reported by many people in that day and time. It mattered not if Braddock won or lost, because he had become the champion of the downtrodden masses. Braddock did go on to win the heavyweight title. We hear stories like that and they make us feel good. They warm our hearts. They make us feel like there is hope. Perhaps in our own lives right now, there's an intense hardship. Perhaps you are experiencing your own personal Great Depression. We know that the economy is not in great shape, but seems to be rebounding. We know that many families have struggled financially. We know that many have lost their jobs. With the Thanksgiving season coming quickly upon us, so many are stopping and asking, "What do I have to be thankful for amidst all the turmoil and tribulation?" Why should we be thankful this holiday season? Many ask, "Where is our champion of the downtrodden masses?" It's so easy for us when things begin to turn sour in our lives to focus on all of the negatives and forget about the positives. Compared with so many in the world today, we have so much to be thankful for. We hear that day in and day out and we say, "Well, I sure don't feel like I have anything to be thankful for." But we do. Our pockets might be a little lighter. And we may be searching for a new job unexpectedly. But we have something that is priceless that has been given to us because a sacrifice was made. Now, this doesn't mean that our lives will be without problems. It's an inescapable tenet of the Christian faith that hardship will come. No one is immune, from the greatest to the least of us. But there is another inescapable tenet of our faith, and that is we are not to become discouraged. Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled." At another time, he said, "Fear not, for I am with you always." And in our text this morning, we hear Jesus saying he wants to share our burdens. I have always been interested in myths, legends, and folklore. I don't know why. Some of the stories are catchy. But there is a legend concerning the quiet years of Jesus, the years prior to his visible ministry. Now, the legend claims, now this is a legend, it claims that Jesus the carpenter was one of the master yoke makers in the Nazareth area. People came from miles around to have a yoke handmade and crafted by Jesus, the son of Joseph. When customers arrived, they would find their team of oxen taken away by Jesus and have a considerable amount of time spent with them, measuring the team, their height, their width, the space between them, the size of their shoulders. Within a week, the team would be brought back, and Jesus would carefully place the new-made yoke upon their shoulders, watching for rough places, smoothing out the edges, and fitting them perfectly to this particular team of oxen. It's a beautiful story. It's a beautiful legend. But the truth to that story is this, and this alone, is that is the yoke that Jesus invites us to take. Don't be misled by the word easy, for its root word in Greek speaks directly of the tailor-made yokes. They were well-fitting. The yoke that Jesus invites us to take, the yoke that brings rest to our very souls, is the one made exactly to our lives, our hearts, our spirits. The yoke he invites us to wear fits us well and does not rub us nor cause us any spiritual sores. And even though the yoke is designed for us, it's designed for two. His yokes were always designed for two. And our yoke partner is none other than Christ himself. As you reflect upon some of the events of your life as we prepare for this Thanksgiving season, I challenge you to ask yourself this question. This question and this question alone. If it had not been for God, if it had not been for God, that's the question I would like for you to focus on leading up to Thanksgiving. Where would you be right now if it were not for God? Where would you be? Would you be isolated? Would you be mentally broken? Physically destroyed? Would you be inept? We have a reason to give thanks. God has not let us down, nor will God ever. There's a theme running all throughout the New Testament from beginning to end, and that theme is that Jesus is a burden-bearing Christ. He's not just a Lord whom we burden with our problems, but a Lord who solicits those problems and burdens. I want you to think about that with me this morning. Those who would be most effective must first be free from their burdens. Jesus is a burden-bearing Christ who sets us free from the burden of sin. But so many times we forget that when we hear Jesus sets us free from the burden of sin, we forget that it is our sin, not His, that placed Him upon that cross. Had He not suffered for us, we could not function, for we would be overwhelmed with guilt. But listen afresh to the words of the Lord this morning. Come to me, all of you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. John Wesley called us Methodists not only to lives of justification, but also to lives of holiness or sanctification, if you will. And we've been laboring ever since. It's an overpowering burden, that is, unless we shift that burden to Christ. Because Christ alone can bear the load of holiness. I've known many ministers throughout the years, including myself, who have undertaken the joyous burden of the ministry, only to discover that that awesome burden of keeping ourselves fit in study, education, and prayer, resisting the kind of temptations that come from lax ministry or self-indulgence, it reminds us that all are not called to the ordained ministry, but all of us are called into ministry. There are two things, two D's that go along with that, disciples and disciplines. And it's the disciplines that I want us to pay attention to. All of us are under the burden of righteousness. Ask Paul, Martin Luther, John Wesley. Read their thoughts. All in their own way, they attempted a life of righteousness, and it almost brought them to their knees in despair until they figured out through Christ alone they regained their strength. So many of us, we give up. In our own way, in our own words, we say, Lord, we've been going to church for many years. Ever since I was a little fella, I've been coming and listening to sermons. Whether I was drawing in the bulletin or as a teen trying to listen or as an adult taking something home, I'm just not getting the answers that I'm looking for. There seems to be so little answer to all of the questions. So please, God, just let me rest and leave me alone. I can't do it anymore. We say that. We say that, and it reminds me of a little boy who so eagerly wanted to help his father. His father was working in the yard, and the little boy wanted to help. He said, Dad, can I cut the grass for you? And he said, Son, you're too young. I don't want you to get hurt. He said, Well, Dad, then can I clip the hedges? He said, No, son. He said, That's dangerous too. He said, Well, what about weed eating? He said, I want to weed eat. He said, No, son. He said, I tell you what, if you want to help, walk around the yard and pick up all of the rocks that you find sitting in the grass. So the young man with a smile on his face, eager to help his father, ran off with a plastic sand pail and began his arduous task. Rock after rock, he picked them up until he had picked up every last but one. How could he miss this rock that was in the middle of the yard? And he went to it and tried to pick it up, but found it was lodged in the dirt. So he began to dig around it with his hands, and the deeper that he went, the bigger the rock became. The little boy, tired and frustrated, began to cry. His father came over and looked at the little boy who seemed to be hurt emotionally. And he said, "Son," before he could say anything else, he said, "Daddy, I can't do it." And his dad asked, "Did you use all of your strength?" And the little boy didn't even look up, but just sobbed, "Yes. I used every ounce of strength I had." And the father took his gentle hand, placed it under the child's chin, and lifted it to his face. And he said, "No, you didn't, because you didn't ask for my help." The father and the son then walked over, and the two of them pulled that big rock out of the dirt. We are the child in that story. We want so eagerly to do what we can in our lives, but then there comes to a point where our burdens get us down financially, emotionally, spiritually, and we say, "God, I can't do it anymore." God says, "Have you used all of your strength, all of your might?" And we say, "I have nothing left." Then God so lovingly reaches down with his hand and turns our face toward his and said, "No, you didn't, because you didn't ask for my help." Have we done all we can do? We can be honest this morning and say most of the time, no, because we refuse to ask for help. Times may be hard and you may feel as if there is nowhere to go and no one to turn to. In this season, you may find that it's hard to be thankful. But folks, we have a reason to give thanks. Our pockets might be a little lighter. You might not be able to retire next year like you thought you would. But because of Christ, our spirits are overflowing. Jesus is that reason to give thanks. He shares our burdens and he loves us in spite of all of our flaws and all of our transgressions. You want a reason to give thanks this holiday season? Well, that reason is Jesus Christ. "Come to me, all that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We sing our hymn of invitation this morning, "From All That Dwell Below the Skies," numbered 101 in your hymnal. We will sing all stanzas, and let us stand, please, to sing.
Go in peace and leave your burdens behind, and know that his yoke is easy and his burden is light. Amen.
May the grace